If you want to make a good assessment of the initial situation, you need good data. All assessment tools require data collection. When it comes to the sewer areas, you will probably have a clear picture. But when it comes to non-sewer areas, you may not have much more than a few reports and statistics issued by the government. Most of the time, this is not enough, and the accuracy of the existing data should always be questioned, especially in context of fast urban growth. Did you ever work with data which were outdated or not matching the reality you saw on the ground? In this module, we will look at which data to collect, how to collect data, and how to visualize data. Through choosing the right methods, you will be able to find a trade-off between exhaustive data collection and the available resources. Remember that it is crucial to first plan well what your data you want to collect, for which purposes, how you want to engage the stakeholders in this process, and most importantly, how you want to analyze and communicate your results. You may not need the same data or the same data format for different outcomes. Think about which data you need when you want to make an urban diagnostic for citywide inclusive sanitation. The idea is to get a comprehensive snapshot of the situation. Start with a helicopter view of your city. You can take a map or look on Google Earth and start by identifying the different urban contexts. What happens at every step of the sanitation service chain for all the types of sanitation systems? What are the existing infrastructure and services? Are there sewer networks? Which type of toilets do people use? Who are the service providers and how are they organized? Does the city have any regulations on sanitation services? How is water and sanitation managed in schools and healthcare facilities? We can consider five assessment realms. First, you have the socio-demographic facts, like population numbers, density, and income. You then have the physical and spatial dimensions, like the topography, climate and natural risk, the local geology, and groundwater table. Once you have a grasp over the structure of the city, you can look at the urban services and infrastructure in the different neighborhoods. Mind that you should not only look at sanitation infrastructure and services, but also at water supply, solid waste management, and stormwater management. This will give you a first hint about governance and stakeholders. Collect data to understand the rules of the game, who are the stakeholders, what are their needs, preferences, and priorities, and the relationships between them. Finally, you should also collect economic or financial data. Talking about stakeholders, we should know what the financial transfers between them are. For example, how much do households currently pay for water and sanitation services in different parts of the city, and how sanitation service providers make their business. It is not always easy to get good data. And when you use a tool, remember that the results are as good as the quality of the data you put in. As we used to say, garbage in, garbage out. First of all, mind data representativeness. Make sure that your data covers the whole city and is inclusive. Mind aspects such as income disparities, gender, age, ethnicity, religion, and make sure that your sample is big enough when you do surveys. When you do interviews, make sure that all stakeholder groups are represented. Check literature about how to determine the sample for household surveys or how to sample wastewater, fecal sludge, or water. And there are a lot of surveys around from where you can get inspiration and even extract questions. Then, mind that the data is often fragmented and that it is your task to bring the puzzle together. It is a great opportunity to move beyond local silos. It is your task. Sometimes you may have difficulties to access data. Information is power, and some people may be reluctant to share what they know. That's why the assessment of the initial situation is also a trust-building exercise, where you have to show to stakeholders what is their interest in collaborating. To this aim, it is very helpful to have a local facilitator or door opener. You have different methods to collect primary data. First, you have qualitative field observation. You go on the field and you see what's around. You can, for example, carry out a transect walk, identifying sanitation hotspots like fecal sludge discharge sites or places creating greater public health risk may also be a driver for your field tour. Mapping is always a crucial step in planning. You can use maps and satellite images, for example from Google Earth, GIS databases or even drones, and do participatory mapping when dealing with communities. The key sanitation stakeholders are precious partners for data collection and analysis. If you want to get qualitative data, there are different types of interviews that can be carried out, depending on the type of information you want and the stakeholder you have in front of you. Interviews can be informal, semi-structured, or led with a group in so-called focus group discussions, as shown on this picture. If you want quantitative data, that is, data with which you can make statistics, you can proceed with structured survey questionnaires, for example, to collect information on individual needs, preferences, and priorities. The most common example are household surveys. Finally, in order to understand the quantities and characteristics of what you will have to treat, be it wastewater or fecal sludge, you may have to take samples and make laboratory analysis. For example, let's consider a key informant interview. Such interview will normally be either informal or semi-structured. The key informant can help you to identify the key stakeholders and understand the institutional perspective. He or she can help you to understand the needs and constraints as a sanitation professional or as an institution. Such interview also helps you to assess the available knowledge, awareness of the problems, and get relevant information and documents. Remember, however, that interviewing people leads to information on their perception of reality and on what they think. When one wants to know what people really do, one had to observe them or get the perception of others. That's why it is important to have different sources of information and cross-check. Georeference data allow you to work neighborhood by neighborhood and visualize your results in clear and attractive ways. Here are a few examples of georeference data visualization. Here, survey results on toilet types in different city parts of Tikapur, in Nepal, using QGIS. Here, a representation of the quality of services with the vulnerability of groundwater to pollution overlap. Finally, a map of Itikwini municipality in Durban showing the level of sanitation service across the area. As presented in the previous module, different assessment tools like the SFD and CSDA help to translate data into visual outputs, easy to communicate and discuss. All this will help you make your reports more straightforward and powerful. Remember that it is important to collect data with different methods and then cross-check and validate. Remember also that an important aspect of this assessment is to engage stakeholders in the process. A lot of diagnostic tools thus use a mix of methods and engage stakeholders in data collection, discussion, and validation. So to conclude, plan well which data you want to collect, why you want to collect it, which data sources you have, how to avoid bias, and most importantly, how you will analyze and communicate the results. I wish you success in your future assessments and trying out these different tools.